Well, in the renal process too, reabsorption. So reabsorption is from the lumen back into plasma. So definition, from the lumen back into plasma. Over 99% of the lumen will be reabsorbed back, and most of them happen in the proximal tubule. So in the proximal tubule part, it's unregulated. You don't need to ask the body, do I need to take the molecule back or not? The answer will always be yes, because you need to take a lot of molecule back. So the proximal part, tubule part, over 80% of them unregulated. The other 20% of them regulated. Depends on your body need. You found your urine will be more concentrated or more diluted. Depends on how much water you drink. So it depends on your body situation. In the distal tubule, the 20% of them, you can decide to take more or less. Overall, you need active transport. So you are working against the concentration gradient most of times. And the concept you learned in unit one, those membrane transport, will come back in this part. And you decide, okay, what molecule you want to take back from the lumen back into the ECF. You have 20 different kind of marbles, so which one come back first? The answer will be sodium. You take sodium back first. After you take sodium back, it helps the anion to go, those negative charge ion to go. And after you have sodium anion, water would like to follow to dilute those ions. And after water follow, the other ions and other molecules want to go follow water. So like you take sodium back, you fix all the problem. So the sodium is the first molecule you take back. And let's look at the molecular mechanism, how to take sodium back. Sodium is high outside, low inside, high in the interstitial fluid again. So you need to go from the lumen into the cell. Apical membrane, from high to low, you put sodium channel. So sodium channel help the ions go from high to low. And on the basal lateral part, you need to pump the sodium from low to high. So this time you need active transport. You put the sodium potassium pump on the basal lateral part. You help the sodium to go from low to high. Now let's look at glucose. Glucose will show up in the lumen. Because glucose is a small molecule, it will be filtered into the lumen. So let's look at the glucose environment. Glucose is low in the lumen, high in the epithelium cells in the kidney, and low again. So it's low, high, low. On the apical membrane, you want to move glucose from low to high. You need active transport. And we use the secondary active transport. It's glucose, sodium glucose symporter. It uses the concentration gradient of sodium as the energy source to move glucose from low to high. And once the glucose inside the cell, you want to move from high to low. So on the basal lateral part, we just put the glucose carrier. This will help the glucose move from high to low. And you put the sodium potassium pump to balance the concentration of sodium, keep pumping sodium out. And because you need the membrane protein, those carrier, those pumps to move the molecules. And in unit one, we talk about those membrane protein, they have binding site. And once you have binding site, they can be saturated. So when we look at the concentration of plasma, say we use the glucose as example. So their concentration can reach their maxima. Like if you have one molecule, it will move back. You have two, it can. And its binding site is four. So when you have four molecules, it reaches saturation point. And when you have six, you can only transport four. So this concentration, we say that's the maxima concentration. That's the renal threshold. So renal threshold is the concentration. So in the plasma, we found the renal threshold is 4 milligram per milliliter. And now let's look at the y-axis. Y-axis is transportation rate, how many molecules can move per time. So milligram per minute. And the membrane protein will transport glucose back. So if you have two, you have four, you found it's a linear relationship. They can take all of them back. But once you have five of them, you can only transport four. So it reached its maximum. When we look at the y-axis, we found it reached the maximum transportation rate, and we call the transport maximum. So transport maximum is the transportation rate. And because of this, we have to watch our sugar level in the blood. For most of us, it's not a problem because we have insulin and we are sensitive to insulin. So if you eat a lot of carb in your body gonna release a lot of insulin. And its job is to lower the blood sugar level. So it won't go over the threshold, make this happen. And what in diabetes patients, either they don't have insulin or they become insulin insensitive. What turned out is their blood sugar level, if they don't watch the carb they eat, then can go over here. And once you go over here, it reaches this saturation point. It can only transport this much and you give them more of it. So some of them won't be able to be transported back and it will show up in the urine. So that's how they found diabetes patients. They have the sugar in their urine. And that's why diabetes patients have to watch the carb they eat, the blood sugar. They want to make sure they stay in this level. It won't go over. And this size tell you, okay, if I give you the transport maxima, 360 milligram per minute, and I give you the GFR is 120 mL per minute, would you be able to calculate the renal threshold? And let's look at the calculation. So we use this. Because transport maxima, that's the filtration load, depends on GFR multiply the renal threshold. So that's the concentration. And I give you the transport maxima is 360 milligram per minute equals to GFR. GFR is 120 mL per minute. And you don't know the threshold. So you calculate the renal threshold is 3 milligram per mL. Renal threshold is the concentration. Use this equation, you can calculate the renal threshold. And apparently we want to keep our blood sugar level in here. So below the renal threshold. And you will do more practice in the discussion exercise. So this explains for glucose, how the glucose being handled in the nephron. And let's look at the filtration part. Filtration part you found is linear relationship. The more glucose you have in your blood, the more glucose will be filtered into the nephron because this part is non-selective. So glucose is small molecule. It will be filtered into the nephron. So the more you have, the more will be filtered in. And now let's look at the reabsorption. Reabsorption depends on the membrane protein. You need to take glucose back. So depends on the membrane protein. They have binding site. They can be saturated. So when we look at the glucose concentration, we found, okay, below the renal threshold, the more you have, the more can be taken back until you reach the renal threshold. You give them more, it can only take this back. And the rate, the y-axis, that's the transport maximum. And after the renal threshold, once the renal transportation reaches transport maximum, and you can guess what happens, some of them won't be able to be taken back, and they show up in where? In the urine. That's excretion. So when we look at the excretion, we found it's nothing until you reach the renal threshold. After you reach the renal threshold, you start to have glucose in the urine. And the more you have, the more will be excreted out. And this picture tell you when we combine all these three together. So filtration part is a linear relationship because it's non-selective. Reabsorption part is a green line. Depends on the membrane protein. So they have the renal threshold and they can be saturated. That's transport maxima. And the blue one, that's excretion. So after you reach the renal threshold, before you reach the renal threshold, you have nothing in the excretion because all the glucose been taken back. After you reach the renal threshold, you start to have that in the urine. And the more you have in the blood sugar, the more you have in the urine. And that's why diabetes patients have to watch the sugar they eat, watch the carb they eat. They don't want them to go over the renal threshold. And for healthy people, you should have no problem because your insulin will keep your blood sugar level below the renal threshold. Now let's look at secretion. Secretion is you move the molecule from the lumen, from the plasma back into the lumen. And not all molecules will be secreted back. Usually those toxic molecules, and sometimes your body want to maintain your body pH so it can secrete hydrogen. It can secrete potassium. We'll talk more about this in the next chapter. And clinically, penicillin is the molecule your body do the net secretion. So during the World War II, they actually have to recollect the patient's urine to recycle the penicillin because they get rid of penicillin too quickly. It's mainly happened in the distal tubule. And let's look at the secretion. Secretions are like this one. You want to secrete the molecules, organic molecules, from the ECF back into the lumen. So this time they use the sodium potassium pump on the basal lateral part. They move sodium out, potassium in. Then they use the sodium as the energy source, concentration of sodium as the energy source to move alpha Kg, is an organic molecule, into the cell. But the point is not alpha Kg. They use the concentration of alpha Kg as the energy source to move organic anions into the cell. So now the organic anions go from interstitial fluid into the cell. And on the apical side, if you use the latest edition of the book, it says you have the organic anion transporter 4. And if you use the 7th edition, actually put a question mark, they haven't identified this molecule yet. So there's a new one. There's a transporter. So it's antiporter. It moved the anions in and moved the organic anions out. So now the molecule can be secreted. So you do the 1, 2, 3. They call this tertiary active transport. Okay, let's take a break.